Heavenly Father, we are bold enough to seek your wisdom tonight. We ask that you be with us as we discuss the business of the city. Item 4 is public testimony. This is the opportunity for citizens to address the council on any topic you wish. If you wish to address the council on something that's on our agenda, you can either do so now or wait until that agenda item. So I have 2 requests. One is from a Miss Tiffany Drake of Saddle, Texas, representing herself. Miss Drake.
Today, I work as a nurse case manager consultant for insurance companies. I stand before you today to place my bid to be your state representative for District 62. I seek this office because I see 3 critical issues before us. Number 1, public education. Recent years have shown a big push to bring school voucher programs to the state of Texas. It is projected the tally after the November election will be 74 votes for school vouchers and 73 against. So we only need to turn 1 vote to no and we can defeat those vouchers. The second critical issue I see before us is affordable housing. The cost of housing has skyrocketed and families all over Texas are hurting because of it. In response to this crisis, I have developed a 10-point plan, which you can find on my website, greatfortexashouse.com. I have looked ahead at the legislative agenda for the spring, and they are already planning to form a committee to address affordable housing. So I wish to take my 10-point plan, go down to Austin and seek out a seat on that committee, and try to make a difference. The third critical issue I see before us is healthcare. Over the last 10 years, 3/4 of rural hospitals have shuttered their doors permanently across the state of Texas. This is a crisis in rural Texas. If I am elected, I will take my lifetime of healthcare experience down to Austin. I will seek out seats on the Health and Human Services Committee as well as the Insurance Committee, and I will advocate to bring Medicaid expansion dollars to the state of Texas. This will infuse billions of dollars, not only into our healthcare, but it would lead out into our economy in general, revitalizing those rural hospitals, closing the coverage gap, creating countless jobs, and most of all, lifting up the lives of everyday Texans.
I'm Susan, I'm the principal at Bateman Park, and I'm happy to be here tonight to present the 2023 financial statement audit. The objectives of our audit was to conduct an audit in accordance with government auditing standards and to plan and perform the audit to obtain reasonable assurance about whether the financial statements are free of material misstatement. So with that being said, we did do a full scope audit of your governmental activities, your business type activities, the 2 component units, the EDC and CDC, and each major fund. So in your bound report, council has this is the table of contents for that, and that's where we'll start. Our opinion, our auditor's report is on page 1-3. There is a management discussion and analysis section, and then the government-wide financial statements, those are full accrual on the page 11-13. Then we go into the fund financial statements, and those are modified accrual. And then we have the notes to the financial statements. There's required supplementary information, other supplementary information, and then a compliance and internal control report. So that is all in the bound report that you have.
The collective request here is a follow-up on action that was taken at the City Council meeting on July 9th. As you may recall, the City Council voted to act on approval of an ordinance annexing the 64 acres that I have highlighted with the green circle here. Concurrent with that, a rezoning request was approved as well, subject to approval of a development agreement. And so this evening, the request is the adoption of that annexation ordinance, the adoption of the zoning ordinance, and a development agreement. Just as a brief reminder of these 3 particular items, the annexation of the property was for the 64 acres. The zoning was to zone the property SFB for single family estate lots, which would accommodate 82 1/2 acre lots. And there is a 2-acre commercial tract on the far west end of the property at the southwest corner of Glen and Old Highway 6.
Hearing none, it's time to vote. All in favor of rezoning of that same 64.3 acre tract of land, please say aye.
Aye.
This evening, we do have two public hearings scheduled to be conducted. The first of which would be a hearing to consider it, take comment, close the public hearing. Moving on to the second item, we would request that it be opened and continued or adjourned until the next regular city council meeting.
Josh Mark, Senator Clinton nominee, County Commissioner, Precinct 1. I would encourage supporting this here. I'm happy to give any roads that y'all would like to take off the county.
Can you fix it before we...
time to bring up that situation. I know y'all done some great work. The city staff here are working with these developers and getting all this land annexed, probably P&Z meeting as well. So we're happy to see that these developers are coming in and willingly annex into the city. That's great for the growth of the city and the county as a whole.
The opportunity to speak about both our taxing rate and our proposed budget going forward, I am going to blend those two topics together. During this previous fiscal year, municipal finance, Paramount Steams will close out this year as it entered it, that being in a strong financial position, as evidenced by the report by our auditors this evening. The city presently has a Moody's credit rating of AA2 and Standard & Poor's of AA. This credit rating has improved year over year for the last 3 years, reflecting a growing financial trust, if you will, in the city of Van Alstine, allowing us to borrow at competitive rates. City staff closely tracks operational costs, monitors, and adjusts programs and expenditures to keep our budget on target and for us to meet the goals that have been shared with you tonight. Division directors work closely with the finance department and city leadership to manage their respective departments, utilizing prudent financial stewardship and delivering high quality work to these people. The quality of work that's delivered really matters to them. The Public Works Department prepared an analysis of water and wastewater master plans to determine the scope of additional infrastructure to meet the needs of the city services area for the next 10 years. We're going to be sharing that with you on September 24th. The Public Works Department continued its ongoing commitment to provide high quality water and wastewater services to its customers. A few achievements in those areas include the construction of new elevated storage tanks. Some of you got out to that site and watched it actually being elevated into place. It's a pleasure as you're heading south on Highway 75 about how you can see a big blue Van Alstine name as you reach out and you're driving into town. That particular water tower will put almost 1 million gallons of water in the area in Van Alstine and will enable us to better weather water main breaks while still maintaining a water supply to our city. Streets, utility projects, public works, working with city engineers, facilitated improvements to our water and our wastewater, replacement of lines on Nunley, North Preston, East Van Alstine Parkway. Projects included a replacement of aged water and wastewater lines and the paving of the roadways, curb and gutter. Parks and Recreation, I call it the small but mighty team, has made many enhancements to facilities and quality of life for all of our citizens in Van Alstine. They've implemented an online reservation system. They've repaved and striped the curbing of Forestmore parking lot. They've replaced the entry sign at Forestmore, installation of a Musco lighting system at Forestmore ballparks, resurfacing of the sand volleyball courts with prodding from Katrina, replacement of the gazebo at McKinney Wilson Park, renovation of Columbia College Gymnasium to soon be the Van Alstine Recreation Center, relocation of the museum. They were the backs that lifted a lot of old oak and moved it from one and they were part of the groundbreaking of the Eula Umbris Robert Hines Park. Public safety, police and fire, police upgraded their in-car video systems, police upgraded their body-worn cameras and tape radio conversion system for police. They upgraded their duty weapons, a new ticketing module that always makes everybody happy if you ticket you easier. They've added ballistic shields, breaching tools, and tactical medical equipment for their safety and the safety of others. They've added two patrol officers to staff. The fire department's added one additional person, so they now have 5 people per shift on the fire department. They've initiated competitive pay plan step plays, step pay, to keep ourselves in a competitive market to attract people both at police and fire. Our public safety facility, which is on that board, is completed the conceptual design process. It's now in architectural design, and we've hired a CMAR. That project should break ground in March. We've negotiated an agreement with the Methodist Church to acquire land on the Main Street between Fulton and Shreveport that will allow us to add 70 more parking spaces to downtown. The cost of that land is $10, so it was a good deal for all.
So, David, you may want to correct anything I just said or add to.
Getting Mayor and Council. Council's preference when we brought this up was basically to have and this was on, I think, staff recommendation too, is as the mayor said, if the council does nothing within 45 days by operation of law, it gets released. But we wanted some mechanism where people could go back looking 10 years from now and see where that had come in and was acknowledged. So the petition basically comes in, and then the municipality immediately, or the municipality satisfies the notification process by giving a letter. And my understanding is that there is a letter that will be generated acknowledging the receipt and the date, and then the date that the operation by operation of law, the ones that are on the agenda tonight, those people will get a letter basically stating that by operation of law their land has been released from the extraterritorial jurisdiction of the city.
This is picking up on a discussion item that took place at the last city council meeting where we discussed had open discussion about garage sale signs, and I believe the outcome of that meeting was the city was going to pursue a pilot program to explore utilization of city-provided signs. So on the agenda this evening is an ordinance that would allow for that pilot program that would allow for city-provided signs. I just want to state at the onset that the way we're approaching this is we're going to allow folks to continue to operate under the current practice of allowing garage sale signs as residential yard signs as we currently permit, and then this ordinance is a separate and distinct ordinance that would allow for this new program.
Very good. A motion to approve with the amendment of removing the 12-week requirement from the pilot.
A second.
And there is a second. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion to approve with amendment to remove the 12 weeks, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Or staying. That motion carries.
Second,
Ryan and Katrina.
Thank you.
Sorry, I missed it.